Good morning, everybody. Welcome to BC's online service this morning. And we're going to be talking about the last days, in particular, the second coming of Jesus. When Jesus was about to leave planet Earth, he did tell his disciples that he was coming back. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And when I prepare the place for you, I'll come back and receive you to myself, so that where I am, you will be also. Now, this idea of Jesus coming back has got some similarities to the Jewish marriage process. In a Jewish wedding, long before the wedding comes, there is an engagement. And once the engagement is done, the groom will bring to the bride's house a gift, a marriage or bridal price. Then he would return home for an extended period of time to prepare a room in his house, in his father's house. Then when that is done, the date, how long it's going to take, he may not be able to tell. But the moment he has finished doing this preparatory work, having prepared the room, he would then come back to get the bride. And that time, he might sometimes come back around midnight. Meanwhile, the bride must be ready. And when he comes, the marriage process begins, and then he will then take the bride with him subsequently back to the new home he has prepared. So likewise, when Jesus said, I'll come again, picture to yourself this Jewish marriage procedure. Now, when Jesus told us he was going to come back, he was also answering a very important question, a question asked by the disciples. And the passage that Jesus made these instructions or give us the clue as to when he was coming back, how he was coming back, and the circumstances of his coming are listed here in Matthew chapter 24. Let's go and read this passage so that we have an idea how it's going to take place. Matthew chapter 24, verse 1. Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show the buildings of the temple. Where are they now? They are in Jerusalem, in the temple. Jesus said to them, do you not see all these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. Now, as he said, on the Mount of Olives. Now, where are they now? On the Mount of Olives. So this description below is sometimes called the Olivet Discourse. The disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be? These things, plural. And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? So you are talking about these things. How many things? Three things. When will this happen? When the temple will be destroyed? When will this happen as a sign of your coming? And lastly, when will be the end of the age? Three questions. Verse 3, we have just read. And now verse 4. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name saying, I'm the Christ, and will deceive many. Jesus begins with a problem that we'll face in identifying the dead because of deception. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled by all these things which must come to pass. But the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, take note, famines, pestilences and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation. Note the word tribulation. That is a key word for this as the clue of his second coming. They will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. I know your NIV says many will turn away, but the word here is many will be offended. It's the same verse. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. Note the word many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations. And then the end will come. We'll stop here. In this first phase, I just want to talk about four basic signs that Jesus shared with us as a sign of his coming. And so the first set, I call them external signs. External as compared to the church, we call it internal. The external signs are not many. They are just a few for us to remember. The first sign I want to talk about is famines. In these modern times, how will famines take place? When there is a national or international disaster, or like a pandemic, when people are not able to sow, or there is weather change and there is no rain, then you begin to have the outcome of lack of food. And so in these modern times, it's hard to imagine that there will be famines. But Jesus said, we will see famines. But this famine is still some way away from the second coming. But Jesus is calling this the birth pangs or birth pains. Meaning to say, this is a start line to tell us what are the signs to expect the coming of the Lord, so that we will not be caught unawares. Okay, now these are signs that will help us, but the church will be given more detailed clues when the coming of the Lord is near. But here is something that we'll see preceding the immediate signs, so some way off. So the Bible calls them birth pains or birth pangs. So famine would be one of them, shortage of food, and prices will shoot up. People will die of famine. The second indicator that is coming would be earthquakes. Now, there have always been earthquakes on planet Earth, but what is the difference? Well, firstly, it'll be the numbers of earthquakes will increase in frequency. Just like birth pangs, the contractions begin to become more and more frequent. So frequency is something to watch out for. With 1,500 active volcanoes today, you can expect, firstly, volcanic eruptions along the known fault lines and along the what is called the places where earthquakes are known to have taken place in the past. So the same places you can have a repeat of the frequency of earthquakes, like in Indonesia, in Jogja, they have got this Merapi. There has been more frequent eruptions. We have got Sinatubong, frequency has increased. Same places increase. And there are 500 underground volcanoes. What is the implication of this? Active below sea volcanoes. The impact of this will be tsunamis. And it was just a few years back, this major tsunami that hit the whole world that caused 250,000 deaths when it happened north of Sumatra. We remember Fukushima, another major disaster. More recently would be Sulawesi, Palu, where many were killed. So tsunamis are the most deadly. You see an increase, both in frequency, in intensity, and in one more, diverse places, Jesus said. Places where previously there were no volcanic eruptions, you see volcanic activity taking place. So this will increase in frequency. So every time there is a tsunami or there is an eruption, take note, because the frequency will increase. The external sign, one of them would be the third one, wars and rumors of wars. Now, since World War II, there are 36 major wars. Today, wars are still going on. Now, what will be the difference in the coming wars? Compared to World War I or World War II, the difference is simply the impact. The impact will be so much bigger. And I've given you a few reasons. One is the development of new technologies. First of all, many countries now have weapons of mass destruction. North Korea, Persia is now developing their nuclear warheads. And also, they are developing the delivery systems, the missiles, so that they can reach almost any part of the world. So these are, what is the implication of this? It means that many people will be killed just with the release of one weaponry system. I've given you in the list would be one of the most, what are some differences? I believe that one of the most significant changes in the coming days that will affect the world in when wars take place is the use of unmanned drones. Can you imagine where a country has millions of drones that carries explosives and bombs being released at one time? It's hard to escape this kind of technological developments in all these military systems, weapon systems. Simply means that there'll be heavier and heavier casualties, particularly civilian casualties. So we have got here the use of germ warfare, now that so much development is taking place with the use of different viruses. Several countries have now developed satellite surveillance systems. That makes them very, that gives them a lot of advantage over the smaller nations that does not have satellite surveillance systems. So that means the weaker countries, the smaller nations will easily be taken over by the countries that are richer and more powerful. It's not necessarily the case just because a nation has got a bigger population. It's no more a population size country that the bigger the population simply means to win the war. Not necessarily the case. It can be a smaller nation with greater advanced technological developments, and they are the ones that probably would have a bigger advantage. So these are the few things. Now the that's the external signs, just F-E-W. But the Lord Jesus did say, the end is not yet come. But it helps us in our countdown to the coming of the Lord, so that when things are happening in the external world, we become aware. We become what we call politicized. We understand what is happening so that we will not be afraid of what's happening. It's something that when we expect it to happen, when the Lord has warned us about it, then we will not be taken aback. All right, that's the first thing. The second thing is internal signs. I call them the flop, mainly happening internal to the church. So I've put in this order. First of all, false prophets will arise. Arise where? Many of them will be in the church. Already in the world today, we have got many false prophets. You heard of the Moonies. And the leader of the Moonies claimed to be Jesus. Many more will claim to be Jesus. And unless we are tutored in the signs, we will get deceived. Because some of them are really very good speakers. They can convince us even when it is false. So these prophets are false. But their falsehood is not so easy to determine. Unless you know the scriptures, unless you know the truth, you will not be able to detect what is false. So false prophets, the scripture says here, will be many. Some of them will do will claim with signs and wonders. So Jesus said there will be many. So this is the second warning against deceivers. There will be plenty of them. And then the key one to remember is L, love. The love of many will grow cold because of lawlessness. The love of many. Many what? Well, I believe there are many believers. The love that they have for people, for God, will begin to grow cold. And only the believers in the church have been commanded to love one another. Even this, do you see betrayal? Self-preservation could be the main reason. So people, even among Christians, will hate one another, violating the command of our Lord Jesus. We're talking about Christians, because non-Christians are not obligated to love one another. But if you have declared you love Jesus, then it's mandatory for every believer of Jesus to love one another. This is the commandment Jesus gave. He said, a new commandment I give to you, love one another as I have loved you. By this, all men will know you are my disciples, if you love one another. So, guard your hearts, because our love for the Lord, our love for fellow believers, and the love for people will grow cold. But what is the description here regarding how many? How many will grow cold? Prophets, false prophets, the numbers given in verse 11 is many. But in verse 12, love will grow cold. How many? It says the love of most. Most people, because they are up against pressure, the love of most. Most what? I believe even most Christians. Most Christians will begin to have a cold heart because their faith has diminished in the light of suffering and persecution. Thirdly, offense. Now, the NIV used the word, many will turn from the faith. But I like the KJV here because it says, many will be offended, because the key word here is the word scandalon, which is offense. Offense is the most common thing among all people. Easily offended. Offended by what? Offended by disappointments. Now, I was talking a few weeks ago to one middle-aged lady, and I asked her, are you a believer of Jesus? She said, yes, previously. And I said, well, why previously? How come you have stopped going to church? You have stopped reading the Bible? She said she was disappointed. I said, what were you disappointed with? He said, I'm disappointed with pastors who doesn't seem to exhibit Christ-likeness. And because of this, I'm offended and I've stopped coming to church. I've stopped reading the Bible. Basically, what she has done, she has turned away from the faith because of offense. Now, we have talked about offense quite a few times already in the past weeks. It will be very pronounced during the period of preceding Jesus' coming, particularly during the period we call the Great Tribulation. People get offended. And I recommend that every one of us need to do a check. I call it the offense quotient. What does it take for you to be offended with God, with people? There is such a thing as vicarious offense. That means it has got nothing to do with you. But because of injustice, you get angry. How come God never put a stop to this? The scripture says God will, but there is a timing. And so when I was witnessing to this ex-Christian lady, I said, you mean to tell me, because of your disappointment with people, you now are angry with God? I said, why are you angry with God? She said, how come God never put a stop to this man? Maybe punish him. Maybe kill him because he's causing offense. I said, madam, if God does that to him because of his sin, what do you think God will do to us? Because we are also sinners. You know what will happen if God carry out what you just said? None of us will be alive. We are all sinners. Yes, we may think we are better than somebody else, but we are all sinners. And if God had taken a step to punish him immediately, then what about us? So vicarious offense, meaning to say this offense has got actually nothing to do with you. But there are Christians who, because they think they have got a superior sense of justice, they depart from the faith. We have read about scholars, even Bible scholars, who depart from the faith because they feel that there is injustice in the world, and how come God is not doing something about it? But right now, God says, you and I are supposed to do something about it. And how do we deal with this problem of offense? It's something we have to do by first examining our hearts. But the scripture says that many, take note, it's in your notes, many will be offended. So, if many, will it be one of us? Does it include me? I would say the chances are very high. Because Jesus said many. Take note. Make sure we are not in the company of these many who are offended. And the outcome is these offended people turn from the faith. Think of it. Is that a bit foolish? God has got nothing to do with this offense. It's a personal problem. It comes out of pride. It comes out of a sense of moral judgment. It comes out of a sense of superiority that I am more just than God. Watch it. This is a common tool the devil uses. That's why it is sometimes called the bait of Satan. Because offense, in the Greek term, is the word bait. It is the bait that is being put in a snare, like a rat trap or a mouse trap. How do you catch the mouse? You set it up and you have to put a bait. So likewise, offense is that bait that Satan puts there. And we are fools to go and take a bite at this kind of bait. And the bait is called offense. Next, it is the word P that stands for persecution. Persecution. Jesus said here in this passage that there will be an increase of persecution of believers. Now, why persecution of believers? Because Satan knows that the time is short. The scripture says that he's furious. Furious with Christians who preach the gospel. Furious with Christians who wants to obey God. And he will go in a major attack. And so one of the signs when you know persecution is when there is no logical reason except that you're a believer of Jesus. There are many countries, particularly communist countries, that continues to persecute Christians, even though they know that Christians are people who will never rebel against the leaders of the country. Christians will never rebel against the government. Yet, they restrict the preaching of the gospels. They persecute Christians because we, believers of Jesus, are in competition against the kingdom of darkness. If you understand that behind it all, there is a strategist out to deal with Christians so that they will not preach the gospel, so that they will give up, that they will be among the many that are listed here who will be offended. There will be people who fall away because there is a war going on. Some of us are not what I call politicized enough to see what is behind the scene. Because the news that we get from the media have all got an agenda behind it. I believe that the devil is having some control over the major media. All right? So don't be so fast to believe what the media shows on the TV screen. and the words they use, my advice is don't be so fast to agree with what is happening. Simple example would be what is happening in the States. Now, I'm not a supporter of any American political party, but it seems to me that the current happening in America would be one example that behind it all, this talk about impeachment, and everybody laugh at Mr. Trump. And all this talk, this concerted effort to deal with him, even though he's about to leave office, is one clear sign of orchestration that is done behind, in the back room, by the devil himself. All right? Here is a man who have outlawed abortion. He is maybe what is reported in the news about Mr. Trump is always very negative. It makes him really look stupid. But your scripture says, look at their works. By their fruit you shall know them. He's the first president who has reverse unbiblical practices, and one of them is the practice of abortion. Anyway, some people say always avoid two subjects when you talk: politics, religion. But these are the two that has the biggest impact in our lives. So Christians should be aware of the behind the scenes, all the strategies that are happening behind the scenes, and to understand who is behind it. You don't find the media saying, behind it all is Satan. Yeah, but scripture says, yes, we are in the last days. So we have to be very careful. Persecution. But on top of it, Jesus says, the proclamation of the gospel. The preaching of the gospel will reach the whole world. And by today's, technology, if every Christian were to do their part, the world would easily be able to be to hear the gospel very quickly. But that will happen before the Lord Jesus arrives. All right, that will be the internal evidence. Things that will happen in the churches among Christians. You will find that this kind of falling away, although it's happened in the past, will now happen at an unprecedented scale. Falling away in the past, we seldom hear of so-called scholars, Bible scholars. But today, you hear of so-called Bible scholars. Scholars who are good in one narrow field, but because they are called scholars, they extend their comments into all the other fields. For instance, you have got scholars who may be good in New Testament Greek, but they are unfamiliar with the whole flow of the Old and New Testament. They pick at the words, the letters. We call it variants. But they don't understand the whole flow of the Bible narrative. They are unfamiliar with the scriptures. But because they are good at one field called variants, they extend their comments to the entire Bible. They misinterpret the Bible because they have no idea what's the background, the cultural factors, the biblical background that the Old Testament has set. And so without any biblical background, they call themselves scholars. They say the Bible is not true. And in fact, they don't believe in Jesus anymore. So falling away even among scholars, it's the scale and the level of people you begin to see so-called pastors falling away as well. But I want to go quickly to the next one, which is the third sign. Now, the third sign will need to give you a little bit of background. The third sign that Jesus talked about is the abomination of desolation. Okay, you need to look at verse 15. Now, this one needs a little bit more explanation. Jesus said here in verse 15, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet, standing where? In the holy place. When you see this, now let me explain from here. When you see it happening in the holy place, give you some background. Nobody can see what is happening in the Holy of Holies, in the temple, because only one person can go in there. There's the high priest who must enter the Holy of Holies only once a year. Now, so how can you see? Well, obviously, the use of cameras will enable us to see, which in times past, nobody could see. So the use of technology would be something that will enable all of us to see what's happening in the holy place. So what do you mean by this abomination of desolation? Jesus said, reference to Daniel the prophet. So what is the clue behind this? It is found in Daniel chapter 7 and 8. Let me explain this a little bit. So if you have got your Bibles and you would like to know a little bit more, then it is Daniel chapter 7 and 8. You'll have to read the whole two chapters on your own, but because of time, let me just explain. Chapter 7, verse 20. It talks about the 10 horns on his head. And it's referring to groups of 10 empires or 10 kings that were on the head. And the other horn which came up, before which three fell, it means one of the kingdoms overtake three others. And the horn, we are talking about the kingdom, which has eyes and a mouth that we spoke pompous words, whose appearance was greater than his fellows. So one of the clues is, who is this Antichrist? Well, the abomination of desolation is about a person called the Antichrist. Now, an antichrist doesn't mean he's against Christ necessarily. What it means is he's pseudo-Christ. He claims to be the Christ. And it says here, one characteristic is he talks pompously. That means he's a boastful person. You will recognize him because he would like to boast a lot. Okay, some people think it's President Trump. No, that's not the man. So before that, let me highlight this Antichrist. When will he take place? When can you expect him to surface that Jesus is talking about? I've got here a short sketch which are in your notes. Right now, this is a timeline. The timeline is you and I are here at the beginning of this timeline now. When Jesus comes, we will rise up with him in the air. Now, this timeline can be explained from 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17. And it says, the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. And we who are alive and remain will be caught up in the air. So to meet the Lord in the air, so shall we ever be with the Lord. So the first thing is this rapture is ahead. Okay? We'll meet the Lord together with the dead in Christ in the clouds. Those that are dead in Christ. We call it the rapture. Some say the word rapture is not in the Bible. No, the rapture is taken from the Latin. It simply means being caught up, being snatched up. It's the same word, so it's the rapture. So we are here now. So we are talking about just now falling away, persecution, and famines. We are now here in a timeline. So the rapture is ahead of us. Now, most scholars believe that this is a starting point of the Antichrist. All right. After the rapture. Of course, there are also scholars who believe that the Antichrist may come just before the rapture. The timetable is not exactly 100% clear-cut, but it's around here. So, and the Antichrist is the one that is responsible for what is called the abomination of desolation. This is a term that is occurring in the Old Testament, and the Lord uses it in the same way. So he is coming in here, the Antichrist. So what will he do? Firstly, we know who he is. He always speaks pompously. From Daniel 7. His appearance is greater than his fellows. He looks like a person who is bigger than everybody else. And then he says that, verse 25 of Daniel chapter 7. All right, now we are looking at Daniel chapter 7. It says in verse 25, to give you some clues as to who he is, what kind of person he is. Verse 25 of chapter 7 of Daniel says, he shall speak pompous words against the Most High. He shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and laws. That means he brings out his own laws that are contrary to the law of God. most countries today follow the Mosaic laws in some way or other. But this man is going to change the laws to suit his purpose. Then the saints shall be given into his hands. It is here. The saints, that means those who are believers of Jesus. And then what else? For a time and times and half a time. What does that mean? It means a time means 1 year, and times means 2 years. Half a time means half a year. So we have got these 3.5 years that will be called the intense. This period is called the Great Tribulation. Great, where he will persecute Christians. New people will be believing in Jesus during this time. And then, of course, the timeline, it says here, now looking at the second coming, verse 27. Then the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom, Jesus' kingdom, is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. So, verse 26 onwards changes to the second coming. Here, the rapture, sometimes we call it the second coming, but it's not quite. Second coming here means Jesus come on earth to rule. So this is the part that... So Daniel is describing this part, the tribulation and the second coming. Daniel is describing the Antichrist and the period of the two periods. Let me try to explain the background behind this. When the Antichrist come into place, the total is 7 years. So Daniel called it the 70th week. 70th week because up to the 69th week of the prophecy of Daniel, it is to do with the first coming. All right. If you don't quite understand this, never mind. But the Bible described this tribulation period of 7 years as a 70th week based on the prophecy of Daniel. Now, what about the 69 weeks preceding? The 69 weeks preceding are timetables for Jesus coming on earth, his death on the cross, and his resurrection. So that is something that has already happened. Now, what happened is that the Antichrist will be someone who is very, very capable. Now, there are passages from Ezekiel 38, 39, passages from others. We won't have time to go into the detail. Let me just summarize from what the other prophetic passages talk about. That this man, who is the Antichrist, is a very, very charismatic person. So the Bible, but just sticking to the passage here, the Word of God is describing this 3.5 years, even though it is 7 years, it's the second half that is called the Great Tribulation. Well, what happened to the first half of the 7 years? In the first half of the 7 years, these are some of the most outstanding performances that the Antichrist will do. He'll do a lot of good things. Like all dictators, the first period of their reign is always filled with good things. Emperor Nero that put Paul to death, he was a very good emperor in the first half. When he became popular and took into full control, then his evil began to surface. You have heard of Hitler of Germany, who put 6 million Jews to death. Well, the first half of his government was full of good things. That's how they deceived the people. Likewise, the Antichrist, in the first 3.5 years, will be doing many good things. It's so impressive. In fact, Scripture says that he would broker peace between Israel and the neighboring countries. This has never happened. You need to know a little bit of history about Israel. Israel had disappeared from the map for 2,500 years. In fact, when I was in school, in the early years, when I look at the map of the world, I did not see any country called Israel. That was in 1953. I remember looking at a map of the world. I heard about Israel in the news, but I couldn't find Israel on the map because it was 1948 when Israel, under the leadership of David Ben-Gurion, declared independence as a new nation. That was 1948, the formation of Israel. Now, why is this important? This prophecy regarding the Antichrist could not take place if Israel does not exist. So 1948, Israel became a nation. For all intents and purposes, Israel would not have survived. Because the moment independence was declared by David Ben-Gurion on the 14th of May, 1948, all the surrounding Arab nations, outnumbering them by the thousands, began to launch an attack on Israel. And I happened to spend some time in Israel, and for a period of time I met with some senior officers of the Israeli army that fought in 1948. They fought in 1948, and they told me that initially there was no way they could win. Firstly, they have no cannons. So what did they do? They take timber logs, put it, cover them in camouflage, and they, of course, used deception, so the enemy thought they had big weapons, but they didn't. All in all, God was the one who preserved Israel. But up to now, only up to recent weeks, some of the Arab countries, which are further away from Israel, have now signed a peace treaty with Israel. But the immediate neighbors have not. So what will happen? The Antichrist, during these first 3.5 years, will be able to broker peace by offering benefits to both sides and manage to get them to sign a peace treaty. It will come. But the problem is this. After 3.5 years, when Israel begin to trust this man, he will then turn around. They thought that this is the hero. But little did they know, Israel, little did Israel know that by the middle of the 7 years, this point, the Antichrist will usher in the Great Tribulation, in which they will betray Israel. Now, these are all found in the prophetic writings in Ezekiel. And so, they will betray Israel. And what form of betrayal they will do? First thing, this man, the Antichrist, will be in the temple. He wants to be worshipped. Now, to understand a little bit more about this, let me explain the unholy Trinity. You know the Trinity, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But the devil likes to intimidate God. So here, Satan himself, the devil, wants to be God. All right? He wants to be God. Jesus is God the Son. So, Christ. So the devil has Antichrist or Pseudo-Christ. This is the one who wants to be worshipped. Devil wants to be worshipped. Then we have got the false prophet. The first false prophet will support the worship of the Antichrist. So we call this the unholy Trinity. Now, the Antichrist wants to be worshipped together with the devil. So that's why they want to enter the temple. So what must be done? Why is it called abomination of desolation? Because it has to take place in the temple. Worship and sacrifice have to be done in the temple in Jerusalem. Now, this means that the temple will have to be built. Right now, is there a temple? No. They have what is called a Temple Mount. There are a few possibilities. There are two mosques on the Temple Mount today. In the middle, there's enough space to build a temple. We don't know how it will take place, but when it takes place, it'll be very fast. And therefore, when the temple is being built, this is the place. In the temple, the Antichrist will put himself forward to be worshipped. And those who refuse to be worshipped would be put to death. Of course, who will refuse? Only Christians. So, now you know something about who the Antichrist is. He is part of the unholy Trinity. You know what kind of person he is. He is a boastful person. 6 times in this passage, the Bible says he speaks in pompous language against God because he considers himself as God to be worshipped. So we know something about who he is, right? And when he will surface, soon after the rapture. But you know, this timetable is not very clear. Sometimes it may be just before the rapture. We don't know. Now, I give you in the notes that you need to understand a little bit about the unholy Trinity. He's powerful. He's charismatic. He's able to broker the peace treaty between the Arabs, actually between the Muslims and the Israel. So why is he so trusted? Because he is able to do peacemaking. But he is a deceiver. And Some say he'll be from European stock. Others say that he probably is an Assyrian, and he will probably be from Babylon. Babylon is now non-existent, but the belief is that his roots will come from Babylon, and the city of Babylon will be rebuilt. So in prophecy, Babylon will, you'll see again and again, Babylon will surface again. And it's just a matter of time. The Babylon that is beside the river Euphrates, the ancient Babylon. So he will probably be from that background. But as you know, today you have got Indians going to America, Indians going to Europe, so that the background where a person come from originally may sometimes not be public knowledge. Antichrist will have a firm grip of the world. But Jesus said he'll put a stop to it, and then the good news, he'll put a stop to it when Jesus comes in the second coming. First, the rapture will meet the Lord in the air, but the second coming is after the 7 years, and he'll come to reign. And when Jesus comes in those days, then he will defeat the Antichrist and then usher in what is called the millennium. We'll talk more about this another time. But this is a period of timetable we are in, and it's important for Christians to grasp it and be able to know what is going to happen and be able to read what is happening. And the Lord Jesus said through the writings of Paul in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 2. He says that we need to know and be aware. You yourselves know perfectly, writes Paul. You yourselves know perfectly that the Lord's coming. That day and the Lord's coming, this day, that the Lord's coming will be as a thief by night. You should know this. All of you know this, Paul says. But you are not in darkness, so that day should overtake you as a thief. And then Paul further writes, therefore, we should not sleep as others do, but watch. But let us watch and be sober. That means have a sense of self-control. Let us watch, Jesus says. Because that day will overtake the world, but it should not overtake those who are in the house of God. God will reveal that last period when the rapture is arriving. The church will be informed. So if you are in the church of Jesus, and you genuinely belong to Jesus, you are a worshiper of Jesus, that day will not overtake you unawares. Unless, as Paul says, like some Christians who are not bothered, who doesn't believe what Jesus said, then that day will overtake him. So, what must we do? Let us watch. How do we watch? I'd like you to discuss this in your small group. You have to watch. You have to be aware. You have to know the timetable. You need to know the signs. And you need to be aware of what's happening with the five key indicators I've just shared with you before the coming of the Antichrist. Let's pray. Many of us are fearful of what's happening in our world today. The pandemic is still not over. but it will come to pass. We will pass, but we have to look out for the coming of our Lord Jesus. We have to set our hearts on the things above, not just on the things below. Not be terrified by what is happening, knowing that the Lord's coming is near. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have set a timetable for all of us. You have set the timetable for the world. You are in control of what's happening in the world. Even though the Antichrist wants to take over the world. But Lord, we know that these periods will pass. We look forward to the rapture. Then, even as your word tells us that you, Lord Jesus, will come from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and we'll be caught up with in the air to meet you in the air. We thank you, Father, for your plans for the security of your people. Help us as we consider how we should prepare ourselves to prepare for the coming of our Lord Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.